Good. All right. One, two, three, four.
You recall a certain chapter where Pharaoh's men were after all of Israel, made God's people flee. God drowned Pharaoh's plans, children crossed from dry land. I'm telling you, God's gonna do the same for you and me.
I believe he is, while others just think he was.
Something a little different this morning at Spirit Lake. Woo, yeah, we got a testimony to share. Does everybody like testimony?
Yes.
Amen. Well, we've got one coming to you from my good friend right here, Tommy. He's got something he wants to share with you this morning, and we've all prayed him up in encouragement. So there you go. Tell your story, brother.
All right, I'd like to take this time to thank you all for all the prayers that you've prayed for me over the last 3 or 4 weeks, and to tell you that Pastor David also prayed a mighty prayer for me on a Saturday here, and which I, after that, I didn't think much of it, except I felt a breeze behind my head, and I didn't see nobody behind me, so I told Ed about that, but anyway, I kind of passed it off, and the next thing you know, I had a fall. And then I got a black eye, and I thought, well, I don't guess that prayer is going to work. But over the last 3 weeks, when I went to the doctor, I found out that my kidney function was at 7, which I knew. But the very next day, I had to go get another, some more blood work, and my kidney function went up to 8. And I was surprised about that. And then next thing I knew, Judy told me, it's gone up to 10.
Hallelujah.
So, praise God for that. And praise God for all the healing that you sent my way. And I hope that God blesses all your lives tremendously. Thank you very much.
Amen. Amen. Wish you all could have been here for that prayer he's talking about. I'm telling you.
Yes.
Yeah, so the roof was shaking. Yeah, it was.
There's something,
awesome.
You know, Pastor David, I've watched him. He is a very, very godly man. I've had some amazing conversation. For those of you who don't know Pastor David, he's the pastor of the Spanish congregation. He is an amazing, godly man. And to watch him pray over people and some of the amazing things that have happened has been truly beautiful. And so, Tommy, thank you for your testimony. Brothers and sisters, you know prayer is a big part of who we are. We talk about it weekly. We're going to have a congregational prayer here in a little bit, and I'm going to be the one doing it. But when we think about prayer, we think about those on the bulletin that we pray for. When God answers those prayers, to hear the testimonies that come from that, that's something we need to be sharing. That's something that our brothers and sisters need to hear, because so often we feel like we pray, and maybe God's not listening or we're wandering. To hear those answered prayers and to hear those testimonies is a beautiful, beautiful thing. And so thank you for that, Tommy. And I encourage any of you who have been being prayed for or praying at home, when you have something beautiful happen and God answers one of those prayers, come talk to me, talk to Ed, talk to... We want you to share that with your brothers and sisters because they need to hear how God is moving in your life. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, just a few announcements for you this morning. First and foremost, there's a lot of people here today. I'm excited about that. Hopefully it just wasn't the shrimp that brought y'all out today, because we want you to keep coming other than that. And we have to feed you every week. We'll figure something out. So today is Benevolent Sunday. Obviously, when the offering plates go around, if it's on your heart today, go ahead and put something there. If not, do not worry about it. We have a fund for that, and we're excited about it, but we just wanted to let you know that today is Benevolent Sunday. If you're a first-time visitor, please fill out a connection card. I see a lot of new faces, maybe a couple that have just only come a couple times, but fill out that connection card in the seat back in front of you and turn that card into the ministry table. If you do, we have a gift for you at the end of service. Would love to be able to give that to you, get to know you a little bit, and catch up with you. If not, I'm going to talk to you at the shrimp boil anyway, so you'll get to see plenty of me. Bible study this Wednesday, 7 p.m. We're going to be continuing in the book of Romans. It was very well attended this week, and I pray that continues to happen. The service this past week was absolutely beautiful, and so I hope to see many more of you on Wednesday nights. Annual shrimp boil, we talked about it. It's immediately following church. We've got many people back there hard at work cooking, getting everything ready. We hope you can all stick around for the event. If you haven't got your ticket yet, it's $5. It does benefit the youth, and the youth will be going around and selling those if you do not have one yet. The performance titled America Sings with Dr. Dar, which is Thursday, March 14th. I think we've got pretty much all of that. Oh, Debbie's got something. Go for it. One seat left for that day. Okay. There's one left. It is down to the end. So if you feel like you're the type of person that's got that pressure and you have to get it, there's one left. And so see Debbie. We do have the van going over there, so there's opportunities for rides and carpooling and things like that. But again, that garnered way more excitement than I thought it would. And so I'm happy about that. And so I'm excited for all of you that are doing that. And I do have one more announcement. I'm going to have Jessie come up here real quick. She's going to go ahead and talk to you a little bit about that. But I'm very excited about her idea on this and what we're going to be doing for the church.
Hi. So it's getting warm. We're getting close to spring, right? April 13th, we're going to have a church event. We're going to call it a spring clean buy nothing event. So if you are starting to clean through your house and you're finding that you've got some things you're ready to move out, but you need to donate them or you want to put them somewhere, bring them to us. On April 13th, we're going to invite everyone in the church to come in and shop for free. Maybe you're in need of something and someone donates it. So now you can take it home for free. Whatever is left, the next Saturday, April 20th, we're going to do a church yard sale where anyone is welcome to come, and the money made is going to go to helping our youth. So between here and there, if you just want to start looking through your house and sort of organize, get together some things that maybe you no longer need, but they're still in good enough shape that somebody else could use them, think of us. There's a sign-up sheet in the back. If you want to help on the 13th, you know, write your name, check that box. If you want to help on the 20th, you can check that box. Or if you're just super helpful and you want to help on both, check that box. There's also a sheet back there. If you have a need, write your name down, write your need. As people are cleaning through, if they look and they see, oh, she needs a new set of pots and pans or could really use some new ones, I've been looking to buy some new ones, I can donate mine to her. You know, people can get with you directly to fill your need, not even have to worry about bringing it here and you hoping you make it on time. So if you have a need, write that down. If you would rather keep it anonymous, get with me and I'll put my name and we can make that work. So if you have any questions, just get with me.
Yeah, you guys all know this time of year, everybody's going through their stuff. It's nice out. We've got too much stuff we've gathered over the winter. We're just going to toss all this. I've heard the saying, one man's trash is another's treasure. now's the chance to be able to do that. Go around your house. If there's stuff you don't want, don't need anymore, we're going to clean out the shed back here. We'll store some stuff in there. This is a great opportunity to help your brothers and sisters in the church that are like, man, I don't have the money to buy this, but I could really use this, and that's what the sign-up sheet's for. This is an awesome event to not only help every single person in the church, but then to turn around and sell things for a very nice price to the community, which then also benefits the youth as well. And so I love this idea. I'm excited about it. But again, it takes your participation to make this work. And so I look forward to it, and I hope you'll sign up. And thank you, Jessica, for leading it. But I look forward to all of you participating. Thank you.
Amen. All right. Let's all stand and sing together. If you can stand, we're praising God's name today. Our very first song, God, Lord, I lift your name on high. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Because He first loved me.
first loved me. It tells of one whose loving heart can feel my deepest love, who in each sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me.
Seated. The piano player is looking at me funny. I have this bad habit of just doing stuff, and I don't tell them ahead of time, but they're so good, you don't need to tell them. It's always a nice surprise. Well, we've come to that time where we're going to do tithing. We're going to do something a little different today, but I'm going to read you a scripture first. This is some Galatians chapter 2, verses 9 and 10, where James Cephas, who is Peter, and John, those esteemed as pillars, gave me being Paul, and Barnabas the right hand of fellowship when they recognized the grace given to me, that being Paul. They agreed that we should go to the Gentiles and they would go to the circumcised or to the Jews. All they asked was that we should continue to remember the poor. The very thing I, being Paul, had been eager to do all along. Our mission's purposes are not new to this church. They are been there since the Bible was written and from the foundation of time. We've been all the way back in Deuteronomy reading the scripture. Generosity to those that are less fortunate than us. The heart that Jesus had for everyone, starting with people like me, the sinners, the lost. It's nothing new. And in that vein this morning, I think you're smiling, so I think Cindy has something that she would like to share that she's been witness to. This is Witness Sunday. I love it. This is great.
Where's Debbie? Okay. You might have to correct me if I'm wrong or help me out. Anyways, Debbie and I, because we're part of the Benevolence Committee, had gone to the heart of Winter Haven and to see the programs that they had and for them to kind of help us put together our program. So while we were there, I was amazed at all the programs that they provide. And I probably don't have them all, but they do so many programs to help out the community, especially families with children that are kids from K to 12. So they have a finance literacy course, which is free, and it's online, and it's self-paced. It helps people to understand finances, helps them to learn how to learn about mortgages and credit cards and savings and all that. They have a savings program that if you start saving and you show them that you could save it's $300, you save it for 90 days. So if you have $300 in your bank, you're saving it, 90 days come by, they can verify that you've had it for 90 days. They give you another $300 to help you continue to save. And they're even talking about expanding it to another three months, but that is not there yet. They have a Jobs for Life. They get people in and they partner them up with other people that have more experience. So the people help them with resumes, help them do like mock interviews and you know, what to say, what not to say, help them out. They bring in people from corporations, big companies, and they tell their stories, and they really and they give them referrals to, you know, where to go, what, you know, what to do, how to try to get a job. And they walk you through all of that. They're supporting you. They have, for those parents that have kids that are from K to 12, mothers with, single mothers with children, parents that may be at a point where, you know, they need to move, or they have to, they're trying to get into a new place or something. They have programs, they have help to for deposits and all kinds of help there. They have a for younger folks that are going to college, they're in school, they have what they call a scholarship house. If you're going to college, they will house you in their dorm for like, what was it, $200 and some odd a month or something, and they, you know, they help you. They kind of are your, you know, like you're in a dorm, but you have your own place, and you go to college, and you know, you don't have to pay a whole lot, especially today with the prices of rent and things like that. So they have free counseling for everybody, counseling of any sort. So who doesn't need that? they also, if they can't help you, they have a registry for those that are like almost homeless or close to it, that they can put you on this register that is, I think you say it better than I do, but anyways, it's like for the housing authority or something like that. It's a HUD.
It's under the Housing Coalition that's here in our county, and they can put you on that registry. And so, if you're a vet that's homeless, they have certain funds for that. If you're a single mother that's homeless, or if you're a young family with school age, it fits you in. And when money becomes available, they can pull you down from that registry. So it's very vital that you get on that registry.
Yeah.
If you're in need of help.
So yeah. So they put you on that registry, and for other places and other nonprofits, when they have extra funds, then they pull from that registry to help those in need. So thank you, Debbie. So I'm sure, you know, a lot of these things don't pertain, but you know, you might know someone, you might know a single mother. I know that it was amazing to me to see how much they do for the community and how much help there is out there that, you know, some of us don't know about. So I just wanted to share that so that maybe you guys can share it with others that might need it.
And I guess you didn't say this, but correct me if I'm wrong. This is a Christian-based counseling service and done in the Christian way, the biblical way, to teach people how not. You go ahead. You probably can say it better than I.
Yes, they are Christian-based, and they do teach. In fact, while I was there, We got to talking, and they also gave me some books to read about how helping can hurt. You know, sometimes we think we're helping, but we're not. So it's all biblically based. So where it's all based on the word in the Bible. So it's really interesting. I just started the book a couple days ago, so I can't really speak to it right now, but it is all great, and they're willing to come into the church or to anywhere and discuss it and help others and explain all of these other classes and about how helping sometimes hurts.
Thank you.
All right, so if we could pray over the offering at this time, please bow your heads with me. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for this beautiful day that you've given us and for this wonderful church family. I pray this morning that as we give our tithes and offerings that you would take it and multiply it no matter how small or big it is. Father, have your way with it. And thank you, Father, for loving us first and for sending Jesus Christ to save us. I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. 1, 2, 3.
Jesus, 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 let all heaven and earth proclaim. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away, but there's something about that name. Jesus, 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 there's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance
again, brothers and sisters. Before we get started this morning, I want to turn your eyes again to the bulletin. I hope I printed enough of those this week. But take a look at all the different names on the back of there. You might recognize some of the names. Maybe you don't. Maybe those are family members, friends of people that do come to the church. With the congregational prayer, we want to remember those people. We want to take time to pray for them, to think about them. And one person in particular, Bob Mitchell, reached out to me yesterday. Carol Houghton's in the hospital. I don't know exactly why. They haven't been able to run tests or figure anything out. They haven't let me know what that is. But obviously, those of you who live next door, I know how important Carol and Bob are to you. And so I told him we would be praying for them right off the bat before I started my sermon. So remember her. Remember all of these requests here on the back of the bulletin. And again, I encourage each of you, if you have a request, whether it be for yourself, whether it be for a friend or family member, if there's something you're going to God with and you're battling in prayer on behalf for somebody else, come talk to me. If it's something you want to talk about, even if it's an unspoken request, come talk to me. Let me get it on the bulletin of the name of the person. Let me get it in the email so we can be praying for those people. You heard Tommy's testimony today. Prayer is powerful. It's very, very powerful, and we need to be praying for those people who need prayer. Amen? Well, let us pray, and we'll get started this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you. Lord, I thank you for all these people here today. I thank you for those watching online, Lord. I'm excited about the shrimp boil after church, and I pray that we get a wonderful time of fellowship to get to know people, people who are here for the first time, people who have come back, or people who have been here for years, Lord. I just pray that we have a wonderful time getting together, fellowshipping, Lord, and most importantly, honoring you in all that we do, Lord. All the requests we see on the bulletin, Lord, we pray for those. Again, we may not know the exact details of every single person on there, Lord, but you do. And so we pray for those requests this morning, God. We also pray for Carol, who is in the hospital, Lord. I told her we would send up a special prayer request for her. Whatever it is, again, God, maybe the doctors don't have it figured out. Maybe they don't know what it is yet, but you do, Lord. And so we pray for her. We pray for those on the bulletin, Lord. Be with us this morning as I go through the message, Lord. Let my words be yours, Lord. Don't let anything come from me that nobody needs to hear, God. Let all of it come from you. Lord, we love you. We thank you. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, over the last several weeks, church, we have been talking about some key points in Scripture as we make our way through Lent, right? With the big conclusion of our talking points coming on Easter Sunday. Now, there's a lot of people here. I think a lot of people excited for the shrimp boil, but I want to see this church completely full on Easter Sunday. And the reason I say that is because that's the time where you can get somebody who may not normally come to church or accept your invite to come. I don't want them to come just so you can say, hey, they come to Spirit Lake, look at our numbers, it's this. No, there's people out there, again, friends, family, people who do not know about the wonderful name of Jesus. And that's what I want you to focus on in the coming weeks, is thinking about that person that you want to invite, that person that you know is unchurched and does not have a relationship with Christ that you can invite. And so be thinking about that. Well, today is going to be a little bit different. We're going to be talking about some very heavy material. You know, you might be thinking, Pastor, you do that a lot. You kind of make me cry, you make me think, you make me get in my feels a lot, and that's okay. Today's going to be heavy, and these things that we're going to be talking about may feel and seem a little bit uncomfortable on the surface. But the things that we're going to be talking about today, I think, are imperative for you all to understand. Today's message is going to be deep, and I'm going to tie it all together so you understand why I hit on some of these hard topics. And the reason for this is, during the Lenten season, it's vital for you to understand why Jesus did what he did. If you don't comprehend the things he set out to do on our behalf, it's tough to truly appreciate what he did for you and I, right? The work of the cross is so beautiful. But so often I feel like the work leading up to the cross is often not talked about. So today, we're going to dig a little bit deeper and talk about some of the things that took place before he went to the cross, right? Now, some of you may remember in previous sermons, I've mentioned there were some nations very close to Israel that practiced child sacrifice at some point or another. You've heard me say that before. In fact, some biblical scholars believe that this practice is what led to the story of God testing Abraham's faith by asking him to sacrifice Isaac. Most of us know that story fairly well, right? Isaac was the son God had promised would be born to Abraham and Sarah, even when it seemed impossible for them to have a child at their age. Isaac was the hope of Abraham and Sarah, that from their offspring, God would bring forth a great number of people, too many to even count, in fact. God then tested Abraham's faith by asking him to sacrifice his son Isaac. Everybody remembers that, right? We know that story good. So Abraham led his young son up a tall mountain where he built an altar to God. The two of them gathered wood for a fire. And when Isaac asked his father where they would find the animal to sacrifice, Abraham took Isaac, bound him, and placed him on the altar. Now, before I go any further, I'm going to talk a little bit more about that. I have four children, three sons. As a father, let me preface this. I love God with all my heart. I love him so much. But as a father, being entrusted to care for them, yes, they are his children, I'm the one entrusted to raise them, to be asked to go up a mountain to sacrifice one of my four children because I am told to trust him, oh boy, that's hard. That's deep. Parents, grandparents, think about that for a second, right? Shaking your head, no, that's hard, right? You have to have a complete trust in God. You have to understand who he is, and the story continues. He took out his knife, and just about as he got ready to plunge it into his son, killing him on the spot, God shouted, "Stop!" So Abraham unbound Isaac and discovered that there was a ram caught in the thicket of the briars. Abraham took the ram, laid it on the altar, and sacrificed it in Isaac's place. Man, that's a story of faith, right? That's a story of perseverance. That's a story of complete trust in God. And this biblical story, it speaks to every one of us in some way, especially those of us who are children and grandchildren. It's a great reminder of just how good God is when we trust him. But it also reminds me of a historical story that I read about recently. This story shows me just how bad people can be, how sick people can be when they think they do things for another reason. Now, before I tell this story, I told you it would be very real, very deep. So understand that I begin this story today. These kinds of things that I'm about to talk about, they still take place outside of the United States of America, right? All across the world, there are things that I'm about to talk about that still take place. The story goes like this. A young child was bound and put on an altar, much like the story of Isaac that we know so well. It was she who had been chosen to be the sacrifice made to the gods for her people for the current year. Notice I said gods, right? So I'll preface with that. She was the one they selected of having the honor of being slain in front of her family, her friends, and her community. To say this little girl was terrified would be a vast understatement. She watched every movement that that priest made, every single movement closely throughout the ceremony. And then at the height of this religious, spiritual, and most celebrated ritual that the town could have, the priest moved toward her with a sharp blade held high. Instant terror flooded the young girl. She knew what was about to happen. The knife came down and plunged into her chest. In just a few moments, blood spilled everywhere. The poor young girl was dead as her blood dripped down to the ground. The first major sacrifice of the tribe for the year was now complete. The people, the townspeople, breathed a huge sigh of relief. I want you to think about that for a minute, right? A tribe of people breathing a huge sigh of relief over the death of a girl that was no more than 7 years old. And the people thought to themselves, perhaps now, perhaps this year, this sacrifice, this time, will please the gods we serve. And maybe this year, of all the years, those gods will look down on us with favor. Now, church, I have the benefit of standing up here, looking out and seeing all of you. You get to see one beautiful bald face up here. I get to look out here and see all of you. I can see the range of emotions. I can see different people and crippled by shock, some people overcome with emotion. And to be honest, this is a strange story, to say the least, right? The fact of the matter, though, is that this story is very, very true for many different people and many different cultures around the world. The practice of human sacrifice is alive and well, and it's used in order to please gods that these nations and that these tribes serve. Now, understand this, church. They are not trying to please the God. We understand that, right? They're trying to please the gods that their families have followed for generations. Just like a favorite sports team or something that your family does, maybe you get together every Easter or every Christmas, or you celebrate Christmas on Christmas Eve, whatever it is, these types of things have been passed down generation to generation, and families will follow suit with that because it's what's always been done, right? The same can be said for these nations, for these people. As time goes on, they follow suit for everything that's always been done. So they just do it to do it. Now, two things can be gained from this story. First is the fact that God's cry to stop Abraham's sacrifice of Isaac in Scripture that we just read was not just an indication of God's grace. We know it was that. It was also an indication to all of Abraham's descendants that God did not desire child sacrifice, right? And that his descendants should not engage in the kind of practice at all whatsoever as some of the other nations were doing. Secondly, since this story records that God provided a ram for Abraham to sacrifice in place of Isaac, people assumed that it was an endorsement for the religious practice of sacrificing animals to thank God for his blessings and as an offering to God for the atonement of sins. Now, brothers and sisters, we see this process reinforced in the first story of Passover. I told you this would be rich theologically. We'd have a lot of scripture put into this. Remember the first story of Passover. As the last of the 10 plagues was about to claim the firstborn of all of Egypt, due to Pharaoh's refusal to listen to God's demand to free Israel. The people of Israel were instructed by God to take an unblemished lamb, right? An unblemished lamb for each household, sacrifice it, and spread its blood over the doorpost of their homes. And when the angel of death came, it would pass over the homes of Israel that were marked by the blood of the lamb that had been sacrificed for their deliverance. The lamb was then roasted and eaten, along with unleavened bread and bitter herbs, in a meal of thanksgiving for God's grace and Israel's deliverance from bondage, right? And that meal, that celebration of God's redeeming grace, has since that first Passover been celebrated by Israel. Even to this day, is the most important festival for the Jewish people. During the time of Jesus, the religious practice of offering an animal sacrifice was such a part of Israel's religious devotion to God. Notice I said religious devotion to God, right? That every Jew was expected to make an annual visit to Jerusalem where they could offer their sacrifices in the temple, the holy house of God, and that is where our scripture will pick up today. I told you it was going to be deep. Don't fall asleep on me. I had to get through some of the important stuff to tie it all together. So, with that being said, John chapter 2, verses 13 through 22 will say this. Make sure I gave her the right one today. I did. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins over of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a market." His disciples remembered that it is written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then responded to him, "What sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all of this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." They replied, "It has taken 46 years to build this temple, and you are going to raise it in 3 days?" But the temple he had spoken of was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. Then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. It's important to think about that, right? These are things that happened before Jesus crucified, and we need to understand them. And many of you know this, but during the festival of Passover, the holiest time of year, Jerusalem was overflowing with people, right? People were everywhere. They came from all over, and when they arrived in Jerusalem, they needed to do two things. Two things. First, they had to exchange their local currency into that which was accepted in Jerusalem. And second, they had to, since some of these people had traveled sometimes hundreds of miles, they needed to purchase the animal that they wished to sacrifice to God. However, as a result of the influx of these people coming to Jerusalem during this time of year, they needed space for more animals, right? And they needed to provide room for those who exchanged currency. So what did they do? What did they do? Since the temple was the center of activity, that is where most of the merchants wanted to set up their shops. It was prime real estate, if you will, okay? It's been stated that due to the limited amount of space surrounding the temple and increased demand during this time of year, that they were actually permitted by the Pharisees to enter the outer courts of the temple to provide for their need and make their sacrifices, right? According to the scripture we just read, it was during Passover that Jesus, he went into Jerusalem and then entered the temple, found the merchants and the money changers, had not just set up shop outside the temple walls, but they had actually entered the outer court of the temple. Now, what does that mean? To some of you, that might not mean a whole lot. But for example, it would be like someone setting up booths in our fellowship hall, right? Be like people setting up booths in our fellowship hall during Sunday service, or even over in the front entranceway to the church. And these people selling tickets that allowed each one of you to come in, take a seat, and be able to listen to the praise team sing. Be like buying a ticket to come in and listen to me preach. If I ever start charging any of you to come in here and sing or to listen to me preach, I hope you get me fired immediately. Because that should never, ever, ever happen. But these are the types of things that were taking place, right? It's completely insane when I think about it. And as you can imagine, Jesus did not find this kind of thing appropriate at all. And so we're told that Jesus, who in Scripture we usually see as mild-mannered, right? He's meek. He doesn't get angry. He kind of just takes everything. He loves God. He loves people. There's no real animation, if you will, right? He got angry. He didn't just get a little bit angry. He was furious, right? So he overturns the money-changing tables. He spills their coins all over the ground. He was enraged with what you would call righteous anger. I want you to understand something. I'm not telling you by Jesus getting mad here the next time someone cuts you off on I-4 to run out the door, Jesus gets mad, time for me to get some revenge. No, that's not what I'm saying. Jesus gets full of righteous anger here. He has a reason to be upset. And so he is full of this righteous anger, and he makes a whip, drives these animals out that were sold for sacrifice out of the temple, saying, "Get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a marketplace." Now, I can imagine that the people who had made the long trip to the temple that day, they were shocked by what Jesus had done, right? They'd never seen anybody act like this or carry on, right? The Pharisee says it's okay. If they say it's okay, then it should be okay for us to do it too, right? After all, they had come to this holy place, this temple of God, to make a sacrifice, to do what all of Israel had done for centuries. They came to make themselves right. And I want you to focus on this. They came to make themselves right with God by what they were able to do, not what God did, right? But they were going to atone for their sins by sacrificing an animal as they had always done. And Jesus literally says, stop. Stop. Now, personally, I don't think that Jesus simply meant stop the trading and the bartering that was going on inside of the temple. I think he was saying stop to this whole temple practice of offering an animal sacrifice. I think he was saying stop to each one of us who always try and make ourselves right with God, right? Because we are not able to do that. He knew why he had come. His time was drawing near, yet he saw all these people carrying on doing things they had done forever when he knew what was about to take place, right? He knew why he came to earth. He knew what was going to happen to him in the near future, and for them to put this kind of time, this kind of energy into something that meant absolutely nothing in the big scheme of things angered Jesus to a point like we have never seen anywhere else in Scripture. I don't imagine it had taken long before the temple guards came up, surrounded Jesus, demanded, "Who gives you the authority to do this?" But Jesus doesn't just answer their question directly. Rather, he says to them, John chapter 2, verse 19 that we just read says, "Destroy this temple and I will raise it again in 3 days." Now, I can imagine. I like humor. I like jokes just like anybody else. I can imagine that the guards were probably laughing their heads off, right? After all, it had taken 46 years to build this temple. And I'm sure more money than Jesus had ever seen, let alone the amount of money he was carrying in his pockets. But then John, the author of our text today, adds in verses 21 and 22, "But the temple he had spoken of was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. Then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken." Church, as we close this morning, I want you to understand something. I want to say this. Jesus, he took upon himself by his nail-pierced hands the whole temple practice of offering sacrifice for the atonement of sin. As Hebrews puts it, Jesus put an end to all sacrifices needed to set people right with God. He did it once and for all time when he offered himself on the cross as an atonement for the sins of the world. What God would not let Abraham do, he did to himself. He allowed his son to give his life that we might all know God's redeeming grace for all time. I want you to think about that for a minute. God did what he would not let Abraham do. He knew it had to be done. He knew it needed to be done. And as much as it hurt him to do it, he did it anyway for you. He did it anyway for me. He did it anyway for us. And as a result, the day of making sacrifices, the day of trying to do something to make ourselves right with God, is over. We could never make ourselves right with God. We aren't capable. Nothing we can possibly do in this world can make us right with God. Therefore, through Christ's death, we're getting down to that time where we're going to hit it and hit it hard. Therefore, through Christ's death and his resurrection, God declared the only sacrifice needed to atone for your sins has been made. Amen? God simply asks each of us to embrace his Son in faith, to trust in his redeeming grace, and set our hearts and our minds at peace by trusting in only him. God says, "For my son's death on the cross is all the sacrifice that I need to redeem you and all the generations to come. Sin and death no longer stand a chance, for Jesus has overcome the world." Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we're getting close. We only have a couple weeks left, Lord, as we talk about some of these amazing things that Jesus did before he went to the cross, Lord. And I pray that each story, each illustration, each message that you've spoken through me, Lord, is sitting and resonating with the congregation. I pray it's resonating with those online, Lord. I pray that those who need to hear this message the most can hear it. Lord, today's message was full of scripture. It was theologically rich as we talked about some things that maybe some people haven't read before, God, and that's okay. Lord, we need to understand these stories. These things in the Bible, they're there for a reason, and we, as godly people, we who call ourselves Christians, we need to understand them. We need to hear them, and we need to be reminded of them. Lord, I pray as we prepare our hearts and our minds for Resurrection Sunday that these messages, they become clear. That we understand that we as human beings, we have no ability to do anything, Lord. All we can do is trust you. All we can do is have faith in you. All we can do is let you be the one to transform us, Lord. So as I pray as we approach Resurrection Sunday, Lord, I pray that you give each one of us the heart and the mind to grasp and understand what it is that you're saying to us, Lord. Lord, as we spend some time in a few moments fellowshipping as we attend a shrimp boil here, I pray that each one of us gets to talk with a brother or sister, somebody who we haven't talked to before, Lord. There's a lot of people here today, God. People who haven't been in a while, people who have been coming for a long time, and people who have just recently made this their church home, Lord. Standing on this side of things, it's such a beautiful, beautiful thing to see, God. And I pray as we fellowship together, as we enjoy a meal together, Lord, that you smile, that you're happy with what we're doing, Lord, because you get all the glory for what's happening. Lord, we love you. We thank you. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
As always, the altar will be open. I listened to one time Abraham Isaac's story preached by a rabbi. He pointed out to me, and I did some research, so I would beg you to do so too, that Isaac was not a small child. He was 40 years old. He had to have a lot of faith too, because he knew what was coming. Tommy gave us that great story of faith. So if we've got something to be thankful for, whatever you might need, please come.
So are you weary and troubled?
Well, brothers and sisters, you all know you're all invited to stick around for the shrimp boil. I'm excited to talk to you, to fellowship with you, to have fun, but to kind of tie everything up today. When I think about sacrifice, so often in this world, especially in the United States, we get hip to saying things like, well, I have to sacrifice for my kid, or I have to sacrifice so they can play ball, or I have to sacrifice to this. And at times that can be sacrifice. But when I think about real sacrifice, when I look at Abraham and what he was asked to do, and that he was committed to doing it, and then I look at our father, and I look at him sacrificing his one and only son so we could have relation with him, so we could be in direct communication with him. That is real sacrifice, and that should be our focus this time of year, is understanding what he truly did sacrifice for each and every one of us. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you. Lord, thank you for this service. Thank you for each person that's here. Thank you for those watching online, Lord. I pray as we go out to the shrimp boil here, as we get together as brothers and sisters in Christ, as a big old church family, Lord, that we have a good time. We honor you and what we're doing, Lord. I pray that blessing over the food, help it to give us nourishment, help it to give us strength, Lord. God, thank you for what you're doing in the life of this church, and I pray that each one of us, as we go our separate ways at the end of the shrimp boil today, Lord, that we honor you by the things that we do, by the things that we say, by the places that we go. Lord, we love you. We thank you. It's in Jesus' name. Amen.
One and two and three and four and...